tss.thesan. Today, we have two top students with us. And for your information, both of them are top in the world in different subjects. So top in the world means the highest mark in the world in a certain subject. So both of them scored 100 marks in some subjects. So congratulations to them, they deserve it. So all of us are taking the same subject combinations, which are mathematics, photomathematics, physics, and chemistry. So now let's take a moment to meet each of them.
Hi, I'm Yan Hui, and I've scored 100 for maths in the recent May-June 2024 AS exam.
I'm Kai Sin, and I scored 100 marks in maths and further maths for the May-June 2024 AS examinations.
So congratulations to them. Well, for me, I scored 98 in math. Not bad though, but as always, I would like to provide the best thing to you, my audience. Hence, the top students are here for your benefits. So what are you waiting for? Subscribe for more benefits in the future. So today, we're going to share the solid advice and the true dedication that you're gonna go through in scoring different subjects, managing your time, especially during your exam weeks, as well as your future plannings as an A-level student. Alright, so let's check it out. Alright, so there are a total of 8 questions today. So the first question, could you give some solid advice for each subject?
So the first thing you could do is make cheat sheets and summary notes.
And another thing that I do is when you're doing questions that you find hard or tricky, you can compile them into a document so that you can refer to them later and study them.
And the last thing we both agree is that you have to do a lot of past years, at least from like 2020 onwards. For my example, I did 302 for A2 papers.
I did not do that much. I did the past year papers for the new syllabus, which is for maths, it's from 2020 to 2024. And for the science subjects, it's from 2022 to 2024.
Alright, so here is another solid advice that I want you to know, which is you have to make conclusion for every single question after you solve the question. What does it mean? It means after you solve a question, don't straight away proceed to the next question. Instead, you have to look back to your answer, look back to your step, and make a conclusion on how you should answer this type of question. So that next time when you encounter the same type of question, you can just directly recall the conclusion that you make, and you will come up with your answer very easily. So now I'm going to take 2 questions as the examples to show you how should you make a conclusion and how it helps you to answer the question. So now this question is from your question 6 physics paper 4. Explain how the steady hold voltage is developed. Okay, so this is the answer. So now after you answer the question, we have to come up with our conclusion. So look at this. This is my conclusion. So for this question, how I come up with the conclusion is that I imagine the whole process in my mind and I summarize them into these 4 simple drawings. So during exam, these images are in my mind. So I don't really have to draw it out. I just have to recall this conclusion, recall this image, then I can come up with my sentence already. So now, how the steady hold voltage is developed. First thing, this is a magnetic field. This green dot in the center is a positive charge carrier. When this charge enters this magnetic field, it will experience magnetic force, right? This FB. So according to our Fleming left hand rule, you can realize that all these 3 fingers are perpendicular to each other, right? So now because this charge experience a force, so this charge is being pushed to a side, it's being deflected. When more and more charges are being deflected to this side, here will be full of positive, 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 and another side will be negative, 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 negative. So one side positive, one side negative, this is an electric field. So now an electric field is set up. That means from now onwards, every single charge that enter this field will experience 2 forces. The first one will be the magnetic field, FB. The second force will be the electric field. So they are in opposite direction. So when the magnitude of FB equals to FE, they won't be deflected anymore. Hence, they will just travel in a straight line. So this is when the whole voltage is developed. So by looking at this picture, looking at this conclusion, I can tell very quickly, this charge experiences magnetic force, which is perpendicular to both magnetic field and current. And then because of the magnetic force, it's being deflected to one side, setting up an electric field. So when FB equals to FE, the whole voltage is developed. Okay, so this is for physics. Now we look at another example for your mathematics P3. So look at this question. The polynomial this is denoted by px. So from A, they already tell you x plus 3 is a factor. That means the root of px is x equals to negative 3. So from part B, they tell you this is another root. So the first root is negative 3, the second root is this. So now part C is the one that we're going to talk about. Hence, find the complex number z, which are roots of pz squared. So now this white color background part is my solution, and also my explanation beside. You can see the black color and the red color words are my explanation, and the blue color part are my solutions. You can see from part A, the root is negative 3. So from part B, the second root is this. Since all coefficients real, so we have conjugate pair. This and this is a pair. It's a conjugate pair. So I do, and I get the answer. We have 6 answers here, which are being highlighted. You see 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. So this is my conclusion. So next time when I encounter the same type of question, I just have to recall these 3 steps in my conclusion. The first step, I have to check whether the coefficients are real. If real, that means we have conjugate pair. The second step is that because this question is z squared, this is a complex number. If you want to find the square root of the complex number, that means you have to let z equals to x plus yi, and then you substitute this one into the first equation here, and then the third step, you do the comparison left and right. Okay, so this is my conclusion. So now you have to compile your special questions, answer, and conclusion in a folder, in a file. So a few days before your exam, take out the file, revise on the special question and the conclusion that you made.
Motivator, remember to join my 10-hour study with me so that we can study together, we can motivate each other. And the second question is, could you suggest some study materials or study sources?
So for study materials, I don't really use materials like reference books. I usually do, well, the first one is passive papers, which you can very easily find online. There are many websites that provide these passive papers. One example is passpapers.co.
The other one is also Best Exam Help.
And there's another website that you can find those past papers, which is Papa Cambridge.
And there's 2 other websites that I will recommend, which is Chem Guide and Chem Revise.
I also make my own notes and summaries, and you can find them on my Studygram called Study with Crystal.
And besides passive papers, another study material that I use is actually going on YouTube and finding resources on how to answer certain passive questions. And there's also YouTube channels that explain concepts for different subjects. So one YouTube channel that I recommend for physics is called ET Physics. I find it a very interesting channel because not only does it explain concepts very well, but they also make videos on how to solve certain like tricky questions in physics. It's a YouTube channel that I would recommend.
For me, the chemistry solutions that I look for, they are in Team KL Chemistry channel. And also, there's a main one that I usually look at, it's called CAIE Papers Solved.
And the best ever platform is the Sun YouTube channel, okay? And the third question, could you briefly describe your daily routine as an A-level student?
On a normal school week day, we usually have about 5, 6 or 7 hours of classes. After that, I would usually spend about 1 or 2 hours doing homework or revising what I taught during the day. The rest of the day would just be chilling and hanging out with friends.
Mine is quite similar to yours. Then for weekends, I usually spend around 5 to 6 hours for studying unless there's like events on campus that I could join.
And I usually spend about 3 to 4 hours on weekends studying.
For my work-life balance, I don't think it's that healthy. But then every day, usually I spend around 1 to 2 hours playing video games. That's considered the life in my work-life balance. Even though my schedule is really packed, but then I met a lot of new people and joined a lot of events, so I still enjoyed my A-levels.
So I think work-life balance as an A-level student is quite hard to achieve because it's such a short time and you have so much stuff to do, so much studying to do. And for me, it started off not that good. I spent way too much time like studying for exams. But as time went on, I started to be more strategic in managing my time, managing between studying and doing extracurricular activities and hanging out with friends. And I would sometimes set boundaries for myself so that whenever I'm doing something else like eating or I'm hanging out with friends, I would prevent myself from thinking about studying so that I won't be stressed out so much and decent work-life balance.
By the way, if you want to know more about time management, you can go and watch this video and the link is at the top right corner.
And the fourth question, could you give some advice for your juniors on their routines during the exam weeks?
So the honest truth about my study routine during exam weeks isn't that healthy. I spend around 8 to 10 hours. I would recommend really to take breaks and don't be like me because I fell sick for the first 4 days of A2 exam. So for example, recent A2 exams, further mechanics was on the first week. Second week had physics P4, P5 and chemistry P5. And then the third week was mechanics and P3. So I did all 6 papers each day for the study break I had.
So for anyone who's taking exams, not just A-levels but any exams in general, my first advice would be to study way ahead. Study like 1 or 2 months before, months before. This is to prevent like not being able to like cram everything in at the last second and not doing as well in your exam. So what I do is that months before the exam, I would just do 1 or 2 past year papers, not that much. Or sometimes instead of doing past years, I would just do notes. For example, whatever I've learned during the day. And when I'm doing past year papers, I would just like rotate through the subjects. Usually I focus on the subjects that I'm not that confident in. For example, I'm more confident in the math subjects compared to the science subjects, so I would focus more on the science subjects. And when I'm doing these past year papers, I would look out for hard questions and I'll compile them. And when exams are approaching, that is when obviously I would pick up the pace. I would do like 2, 3, or 4 past year papers per day. The subjects I study would depend on what papers are coming up. So for example, if the first paper I take is a further mathematics paper, then I would study further maths first. And let's say if there are exams that are like consecutive days, for example like physics and then like a chemistry paper, then prior to those few days, I would rotate through those 2 subjects, just keep doing those passive papers. And usually 1 or 2 days before the exam, the night before the exam, I would just go through any notes that I made or the hard questions that I have compiled previously, kind of just look through them as a last reminder for my exams coming up. And as for advice for exam, rest is important. I got sick a few days before my A2 exams. That was not fun. My advice would be take break and if you can, have a healthy work-life balance. But
if any of your siblings, cousin, or juniors are secondary school students on the SPM syllabus, be sure to share this video to them because in this video, I show how they could collect my powerful sejarah tutorial videos and my note that will save them at least 100 hours in studying sejarah. I guarantee by using my personal method. Coming from a student who scored 100 marks in sejarah kertas 2 but 2 times in form 5. So I already put this video link in the comment box below. Make sure you share this video link to your junior in any group chat. Thank you, let's continue with the A-level video.
And the fifth question, could you describe some extracurricular activities that you join and give your advice to your juniors on extracurricular activities based on your experience?
The majority of activities that I do are in clubs in my college. So for example, I was the vice president and currently am the president for one of the clubs in our college. I was also in one of the volunteer clubs. I was in both clubs for about a year.
For me, I joined the A-level student council as a public relations department. And maths club and cybersecurity club, they were also related to graphic designing. And then I'm just a normal member of a tech club because I'm really interested in the coding side of STEM. For chilling, I just play weiqi with my classmates.
So for how often these extracurricular activities happen, it usually depends on the club. For example, the club that I run, we try to do activities every week or every 2 weeks, so it is quite often. But for the volunteering events, you get to choose whether you want to sign up for any events or not, so it is completely up to your schedule. So it will highly depend on like what types of activities that you're doing.
Student council, I would say, is very busy with meetings and events being held 2 to 3 times a week. Sometimes you have to spend extra hours late into the night on campus just to make sure that the event will go well. But I think it's quite a good experience gain, and you can write about it in your personal statements when you apply for jobs and stuff. For the other positions I've taken, they were after I retired from the council because it was impossible to juggle that many positions at the time. And the graphic design one was because they're just my hobby and I'm quite passionate about them.
So what I think is good is to do extracurricular activities that are related to your studies and something that you're passionate in. I'm interested in the STEM subject, so a lot of the extracurriculars that I do are related to STEM. And another type of extracurricular activities that I would recommend is just activities that would help you chill and relax. The third type is any activities that has to do with like volunteering that you can show leadership skills in, because those are very good in learning soft skills, gaining experience that you won't usually find in your studies. It might prove useful when you're applying for unis or any scholarships in the future.
And the sixth question, could you briefly talk about your future planning?
So as for future plans, I am planning to study in the UK and I am planning to study electrical and information engineering.
For me, I'm planning to study either at NUS or NTU. I might take data science or computer science depending on which I'm more passionate in.
And the seventh question, could you share about the scholarship that you applied?
So for me, studying in the UK, most of them are local scholarships such as Khazanah or Maybank. So these scholarships, they will provide full tuition fee scholarships, so they will cover your entire studies. But because it is full tuition fee scholarship, it is usually quite competitive. You will need to get 3 or 4 A stars on top of like be good in your extracurriculars. You have to show leadership skill, all of that stuff.
So for the scholarships, currently I haven't applied for any, but I'm looking at the ASEAN scholarship and Turing AI Scholar Program at NTU. And based on my research, the A-level results required is definitely 4 A-stars. And they are all scholarships with full tuition fee waiver and 3 years bond with the Singapore government. Applications for scholarship will start when the uni applications start, and all the info are at their websites.
And the 8th question, could you give some advice to your juniors, to those A-level students who are still considering what to study and where to study after their A-level?
The way I decided on Singapore is mainly because my parents wanted me to go there and I'm not that picky. And I didn't really apply for any other unis because I don't plan to go anywhere else than Singapore. The other thing is because Singapore has offices of the companies I want to work and try to intern at, including Coyolus, which you might know is Genshin Impact and Honkai Star. And that's why I'm quite interested in the gaming industry. And who helped me a lot with this is my mom. It helps me decide whether this is the correct path I should go on after the years of her raising me. She'll know my personality and stuff.
So one good thing about A-levels is that it is an internationally recognized curriculum. So that kind of doesn't really limit which countries that you can go to. So I would say that there are multiple criteria that can decide where you want to study at. For example, like what the environment of the country is like, or what your financial like capabilities are. So I'm planning to go to the UK because the universities there are usually quite good and they have like high rankings. As for what course to pick, there's a lot of resources online. There are a lot of forums online where you can talk to current university students in like different universities. You can kind of talk to them, get a feeling of what they study on a daily basis.
So another tip for you to decide what to study and where to study is that you just search on Google a random university, for example, Sunway University, courses. Okay, and then you will see here. And then you will see there are a lot of courses here, diploma, undergraduate, and postgraduate. For example, if you're interested in actuarial science, so you just click into this. So you scroll down, you will see here are the syllabus that you are going to learn if you take this course. So you will have a clearer picture on what this course is about. And then if you think that you want to know more about this course, then you can just contact them, contact the hotline. So you just search for the contact number of that university, and then you just tell them that you want to consult for what course, and then they will help you to transfer the line to the person in charge. So you can do the same, you can search for the other uni as well, and then you go inside local undergrad. You can see a lot of courses are here. You just go through one by one to see which one you wish to look into, then just consult.
Alright, so a big thanks to both of our top students today. So don't forget to smash the like button below and subscribe to my YouTube channel. I'm the Sun. Have a nice day!
Okay, yeah.